Hi guys, Matt here. Recently I've noticed a lot of people with interest in flying long distances, perhaps because of the release of the TBS Crossfire Micra TX. I'd like to take this opportunity to talk about the different video frequencies, different antenna options, different receivers, and how they affect flying long distance, as well as maybe impart a little bit of the experience that I've gained over this past year, year and a half. Now, before I get into all of that, let me give you a warning. You will lose a quad. It may not happen tomorrow, it may not happen the next day, but it will eventually happen. You will lose your flying craft. It could be an eagle attack. It could be a prop falling off. It could be the video transmitter antenna falling off. It could be you just screwing up, but you'll lose a quad. It's inevitable. Get used to it now. If you go into this with that in mind, it will save you a lot of heartache in the future. Don't get attached to your quads. They're tools. Don't get attached to your cameras. It's a tool. You're going to lose it. Say, have enough money to buy another one. That's all I can say. So, let's jump into this. Let's talk about video frequencies first. There are three different video frequencies that are commonly used. The most common is 5.8. That's what all the racers use. Second most common, it's probably 1.3 that's used a lot in wings. And the least common, perhaps, is 2.4. But for me, 2.4 is ideal. And I'll explain why. But first, what do these numbers mean? 5.8 gigahertz. That's basically the frequency of the wave that is carrying the video information. That frequency is high, which means that the wave is very small. Consequently, the antennas are very small since they need to capture that wave. 2.4 gigahertz antennas usually are a little bit larger because they need a little bit more wire to capture the wave. And 1.3 are even larger, so they're quite a bit larger. What does that mean? Well, in terms of advantages, 5.8 is ideal for mini quads. It's small, it's compact. 1.3 is large, not so compact. What does that mean for flying long distance? Well, longer wavelengths travel farther in the air with the same amount of transmitting power. So a 200 milliwatt 1.3 video transmitter will transmit farther than a 5.8 200 milliwatt video transmitter. There are some other advantages to longer wavelengths. For example, when small wavelengths, they don't really bend around objects. So if you go behind something, you lose line of sight and the video cuts out quite abruptly. The longer wavelengths, the wave kind of bends around objects, which is really good. And it gives you a little bit more feedback about when you're about to lose video. And that is very important, believe me. Especially if you're flying really long distances, you want to have enough time to take corrective action. So, there are some specific problems with some of these frequencies. 5.8 is readily absorbed by water. So if you fly behind a leafy tree, you'll get really bad video. If you have a friend that walks in front of you at the flying field, he'll cut your video. And that's not really ideal. You don't really want to be worrying about that when you're flying long distances. 2.4 gigahertz, on the other hand, doesn't have those problems. 1.3 doesn't have those problems. But 2.4 has some problems with interference. Typically, control systems, radio control systems run on 2.4. Wi-Fi runs very close to 2.4. So those can cause interference in your video feed. And that's not really ideal either. In 1.3, you have to deal with problems with interference from your own control system. If you're using 433 megahertz, 1.3 is a multiple of that. So you get interference on your video. 900 is very close to that. So you get interference in your video. So there, you can get around that using filters, but those are some of the issues. When I started out flying long distance, I decided on 2.4, mainly because of the antenna size. That was the biggest issue for me. I didn't want to be hauling around big antennas. So I wanted a little bit smaller antennas, but I still wanted more range. So I bought into 2.4. Now there are antennas out there that are much smaller. The singularity antennas from TrueRC, those are omnidirectional antennas. We'll talk about that a little bit later. But those are really, really nice and really compact. The problem is that receiving antennas, still quite large, especially the directional antennas. So there's no real ideal system for flying long range. They each have advantages and disadvantages. Which is best? You guys have to decide. Right. So let's talk a little bit about antennas now. You're going to find two basic types of antennas. You're going to find directional antennas and you're going to find omni antennas. Directional is really good for going in one direction and omni is good for flying all around you. There are various different types of directional antennas. I have used mostly a patch antenna or the crosshair from TrueRC. You have helical antennas, you have pepper boxes, which are kind of two crosshairs put together. What are the advantages and disadvantages of them? Well, you should be looking at beam width. Beam width is very important. For example, here I have a 5.8 gigahertz immersion RC patch antenna. So this is 13 dBi. That's the other thing that you want to look at. 13 dBi basically tells you how weak a signal it can pick up. So 13 dBi can pick up a really weak signal. In other words, you can fly really far away from you. However, this has a beam width of 35 degrees. So outside 35 degrees, the signal drops off drastically. That's bad. So if you fly out of line of sight, if you fly out of the beam width, you lose video. Now, if you have some way to track your craft, like an antenna tracker, then you get lots of range and you don't really have to worry about flying outside the beam. However, if you don't have that, then you have to start worrying about that. So then that brings up the other option, my other favorite antenna, which is the crosshair. This is a TrueRC X-Hair. VAS has its own version of this. And this has a beam width of 110 degrees, but it's only 10 dBi. So it's less range, but it has more beam width. Effective beam width is only 35 degrees. Outside that, then you start losing dBi. Even in that, you lose dBi. You have about 7 dBi at the 35 degrees marks, and then it fades off gradually. Well, that's actually good because you want feedback when you're flying long distance. Like I said before, you want to know when you're about to lose video. So that's a crosshair. Now, so let's talk about antenna size. This is a 5.8 crosshair. This is a 2.4 crosshair. You can see the difference. Obviously, you're not going to want to be wandering around with this on your head. It's big. It's heavy. It's cumbersome. It doesn't work. So you'll probably want to connect this to a ground station or a diversity receiver or something like that. Something on the ground. This is easily stuck on your headset. So that's good. The other commonly used distance antenna is like a helical or a Yagi, something like that. Those are good. They also have basically directional signals, and they have their own advantages and disadvantages. You have to explore those, look at the beam width, look at the dBi to figure out what is best for what you want to do. I will say one thing. Helicals with lots of turns are very good for flying long distances in a very small beam. So be aware of that. Helicals with a lower number of coils have larger beams, but less dBi. So there's a trade-off there. So that's directional antennas. There's other variations. You can explore them. But those are the main directional antennas. Omnidirectional antennas. Well, there's more than I can name. There's tons of them. This is an air screw, a 2.4 gigahertz air screw. I like these in terms of 2.4 gigahertz, but it has some problems. I don't know if you can see this, but this is damaged because these are very propense to being sucked into your props or being damaged when you crash, or so they're kind of fragile. I don't really like them. That's one good thing about 5.8 is 5.8 is you have small antennas and they're fairly resistant. You can make them fairly resistant. Now, I mentioned before the true RC singularity. I really like that. I like that idea. I haven't got mine yet. I'm waiting for mine. But the 2.4 gigahertz is much smaller. It's about maybe a quarter of the size, which is excellent for putting on your quad and having something more or less protected. So that's the omnidirectional antennas. I'm not going to talk too much more about that now. Let's talk about ground stations and diversity receivers and whatnot. You have a variety of different diversity receivers out there, receivers, ground stations, receiving modules, whatever you want to call them. There's a variety out there. You have the goggles. So if you're going with 5.8, then pretty much all goggles have that. If you're going with 2.4, there's not a lot of options out there. This is a 2.4 gigahertz Fat Shark module for my Fat Shark HDs. This is nice. Combined with an Omni antenna, it will get you about 2 kilometers, which is pretty decent in ideal conditions, of course. But that's pretty decent. You can do a lot of flying in 2 kilometers, more than you probably have battery in your quad. So you're not really limited by video. You can go anywhere. And that's why I like these. You want to step up your game, go a little bit farther. You probably want something like a diversity receiver. So here is a Duo 2400. I quite like this. I use this a lot. I typically stick my crosshair on here and I stick the Omni on there. And with that, I have more range than I need. I can go in any direction and I can go really, really far in one direction. And that's good. How does this work? Well, it basically measures the signal on each of the antennas and chooses which one is best. Very handy. There are different types of diversity systems. I'm not going to get into them, but you need to do a little bit of research to see which is best, which is worst. Any diversity system is probably going to be better, probably going to be better than a single antenna. But like I said, it depends on what you want to do. Right. So we've talked about frequencies, we've talked about antennas, we've talked about receivers. Now, I'm going to give you a little bit of advice. Some of the stuff that I've learned doing this. Number one, orient yourself. Instead of taking your first battery and going out and flying long distances, take a flight, spiral out, so you get an idea of where you're at. This is really important if you're in an unknown area, if you're in a flat featureless area. It's really, really easy to get lost flying long distances. And it's really embarrassing to have to tell people, oh, how'd you lose your quad? Yeah, I got lost. It's embarrassing. Don't do it. You know, just fly a battery, orient yourself, find landmarks to help you guide yourself back, whatever. Figure out how to orient yourself. Number two, have a spotter. Spotters help. Spotters help when you're not sure how to get back. They can kind of guide you in, but typically if you're using something like the Core PNP Pro or FPV Vision, it has a lot of information on the screen. And when you're flying long distance, sometimes that information is helpful and sometimes it's harmful. You have so much information. Yeah, you're really attuned to what the quad is doing because it's so long, such a long distance. You're trying to anticipate everything. You're trying to figure out, was that the wind? Was something wrong with my quad? Why is my quad moving like that? Oh my God. And then what battery do I have left? How much battery do I have left? What's my signal like? What's my receiver signal like? All these things that are there, their information, and you can get overwhelmed really easy. So having a spotter with you, especially on the goggles, and you tell them, give the spotter one job or two jobs, something that takes a little bit more load off of you, so you can concentrate on the things that really matter, like flying and figuring out how to get back and et cetera, et cetera. Whatever you deem necessary. So advice, have the spotter, give them a job. Number three, set up a level mode on a switch. Why? Why not put a failsafe? Why not do something like that? Well, failsafe usually is bad. You don't really want to go failsafe in full throttle in level mode. Maybe you could. But my experience is that you're going to lose video before you lose control. So as you're losing video, or when you lose video, you have control. You have a little bit of input. So if you flip the level switch and punch out, give it all your throttle, most likely you're going to get your video back. And this was very crucial in my last video. If I had that, I probably would have saved my quad, because I dived behind a mountain and my video just cut out immediately, but I still had control. If you look at the last frames of that video, you'll notice that the crossfire link quality was still 95%. So when that cut out, I could have flipped the level switch and it would have leveled out, hopefully, and I could have just given it throttle and it would have lifted up and gotten beyond the mountain, and I would have had line of sight again. So level switch, level mode on a switch is good. Number five, do a pre-flight check. Prop nuts, make sure they're tight. Check the motor mount bolts, make sure they're tight. Check the antenna, the video transmitter antenna, make sure it's tight. Just make sure your quad is ready to go. Make sure your whatever you're flying is ready to go, so you don't have any surprises. It's really bad if you lose video, if you lose a motor flying over a lake, if the antenna falls off when you're 2 kilometers away from yourself. It's not pleasant, let me tell you. And you're going to lose a quad. And last but not least, have fun. This is a great hobby. It's enjoyable. It's challenging. So just have fun. That's all I can say.